Welcome to the fourth and final part of my Son of Canucksploitation-a-thon. And hey, this time I'm doing a movie people might have actually heard of. The Gate is a 1987 Canadian-American horror movie that, even if you didn't catch it in theaters, you may have seen it on cable or at the video store, because when I was a kid, this movie was a staple of just about every horror movie section. Not bad for a PG-13 movie. And unlike a lot of PG-13 horror movies who are forced to get that rating by making a bunch of cuts, this movie never feels like it's been chopped up or is pulling its punches. See? Turns out you can make an effective family-friendly horror movie. And by that I mean a horror movie that both kids and adults can enjoy, and not a kids movie that happens to have some Halloween decorations in it. The movie's directed by Tibor Tokach, so nice to know what Tibor was doing before Homer Simpson blamed him for everything at the nuclear power plant. I'm not exactly sure where this movie takes place, but because it's an 80s Canadian horror movie, I'll just assume it's somewhere in the US. And come on, kid, don't just stand there and watch TV. I'm still trying to recover from watching Things last episode. Great, not only did this kid's family not wait until he got home to eat dinner, but they also expect him to do the dishes, too. And I don't know if going up a tree in the middle of a lightning storm is a good idea, kid. See? Told ya. Not to worry though, it was all just a dream. A dream that apparently really happened since the tree is down. Whatever, this still makes more sense than the opening dream sequence from Things.
Seriously, after watching Things, it is so good to be watching a Canadian horror movie made by people who actually know what they're doing.
Hey, come on, kid, get out of the way and let those guys do their job. I don't care if you found a dinosaur egg full of diamonds. Our main character is Glenn, played by Stephen Dorff, who's best known for being the villain from Blade and making Isig seem even douchier. There's also Glenn's friend Terry, who I'm pretty sure grows up to become Brian Posehn.
What's that thing called again?
A geode. You know how much you can get for a big one? $100.
Well, yeah, but is that $100 American or Canadian?
Also, turns out the gate the title was talking about is really more of a pit, although I guess that name was already taken. Congratulations, boys, you've just struck Brontosaurus Turd Gold. Almost makes up for Glenn's buzzkill big sister.
You promised I could have these.
I said that 3 months ago. They've been sitting in my room.
You promised we could launch these.
I'm going shopping with Lori and Linda.
Ow, wait! What about the Thunderbolt?
Don't worry, Glenn. I'm sure you'll end up using that in the finale.
And whoa, take it easy, kid. Save that stuff for the rap party. You know, I think something funny might be going on with that hole.
What's with you today?
But Terry told me something. Well, he said a long time ago, when they were building our house, a workman got killed. And the other workman didn't want to tell the police, so they sealed him up in one of our vaults.
Oh, really? I heard your house used to be a cemetery, but they only moved the headstones and not the bodies.
Let me tell you something about Terry. You remember last year when Terry's mom died?
Good, just wanted to remind you. Anyway, good night, son. It's funny I mentioned the pit earlier, since the plot of this movie involves the parents going away on business for the weekend and leaving the kids at home, too. The main difference being, Glenn doesn't freak me the fuck out.
Remember, you stay in this weekend.
Okay, and I brought the house clean when we come home. No parties!
Well, you shouldn't have said that.
No parties!
See, rule number one of 80s cinema, saying no parties instantly makes a party appear in the next edit. Also in the 80s, people used their pets as inspiration for their hair. Why do I get the feeling the killer from Sorority House Massacre is about to bust in? Looks like Glenn and Terry aren't invited, but who needs them when you can just sit in your room and get high off your geode?
Look, I made some kind of marks.
It's words.
Sure.
I think those are just the names of some of the metal bands on your vest there, Terry. Damn, looks like even the hole is partying. It's about to hotbox the whole neighborhood. Things really get out of hand when the kids decide to sit around and tell ghost stories?
And in his lap is the severed head of her boyfriend. And he's tearing out hair by the handful.
Okay, I guess the parents didn't need to get a babysitter. These kids are lame.
They decide to switch things up by inviting Glenn to play Light as a Feather, Stiff as a Board, which I guess still beats the cliche of using a Ouija board in a horror movie. Not to mention, this trick apparently works.
Well, tough luck, kid, but back in the 80s, the only magic that impressed teenage girls was David Bowie's crotch bulge from Labyrinth. Besides, now that the party's over, maybe you can watch a late-night monster movie on cable. I hear the gate is on. Or you could just watch moth sex, I guess. And never mind the moths, I think Freddy Krueger might be trapped inside your drywall. And that's not the only weird thing going on.
Terry, I love you. I need you.
Aw, man, I was hoping my first wet dream wasn't gonna be about my dead mom, but... oh well, I'll take what I can get. But wait a second... So you're more scared of a dog than your ghost mom? You know, it's not that unusual for a dog to die in an 80s horror movie, but I think this is one of the only ones where it just dies of old age.
He was really old.
Yeah.
He was 97.
97? Shit, that's like 600 in dog years. With all this weird stuff going on, there's only one thing to do. Call Batman. Also in the 80s, apparently the finger in wall socket look was in. Well, hopefully Terry's doing okay.
If you leave me now, you'll take away the biggest part of me. Ooh, no, baby, please don't go.
In a time before the Earth, before the sun, and before the light of the stars.
Ooh, Spinal Tap Live at Red Rocks. Oh, wait, I guess it's this album. You know, I hear if you play this record backwards, it tells you to stay in school and eat your vegetables. Give the kids credit, they're the only ones who seem to realize something weird is going on here.
What's the matter with you guys? Something really scary happened last night.
What?
The levitation!
Hey, little man. That was just an illusion.
Okay, so then Glenn's secretly Chris Angel. Either way, you should be a lot more impressed by this. I don't know why Glenn is so worried about the hole in his backyard. Just blame the tree removal guys for not covering it up properly.
I think I know what this means. You know, with the levitation. You got demons.
Hey, as long as it's not vampires, we should be okay. There you go, just put a band-aid over it. Problem solved. Now you can show Glenn your new metal album.
They wrote their own music, but they got their lyrics from this thing called the Dark Book. That's like the Bible for demons.
Yeah, or like the Necronomicon for movies that aren't Evil Dead. I don't know if the liner notes to a Saxon album are gonna help you much here, guys. Terry explains that the gate to the demon world can be opened if a sacrifice is thrown in the hole, but they didn't say anything about the sacrifice being human. Well, congratulations, pal. You just opened a gateway to hell all because you were too lazy to grab a shovel. Hopefully Terry knows how to close it.
The demons can only be destroyed and the gate closed once again by a true spirit of gentle passions wielding energy derived from pure love and light.
Look, you're wasting your time, kid. The real secret to closing the gate can only be found in Captain and Tennille's Love Will Keep Us Together. Or hey, you could just hire a landscaper. That might do it. So, does this mean the gate's closed now?
And I got these new jeans, but I've got to put them in the washer.
I thought you were going to the beach tonight.
We're having a summer party.
And you're not invited.
Okay, you are just asking to get killed in a slasher movie. In fact, I wish you would.
What are you doing? Probably fagging off.
Okay, movie, I get it. You're rated PG-13.
Hey, eat your feet, dwarf.
Suck my nose till my head caves in.
PG-13? In addition to foreshadowing the weapons they're gonna use later, Terry and Glenn also learn a bit more about the demons.
Minions. Oh, boy.
No, the minions are a lot more overexposed and annoying than these things. And I got some bad news for you, Glenn. The effects team just got here, and believe me when I say, they are not fucking around. Ah! Oh shit, the demons are doing my Canucksploitation-a-thon intro!
Hey Terry, wake up! Terry?
Real cute.
Fun fact, before the internet, people had to be trolled by actual trolls. It's a good thing your parents are finally home.
Dad! You've been...
Hey, just because this is a PG-13 horror movie doesn't mean we can't still have some gore. The front door looked pretty clear when you checked it a second ago. No? Still gonna use the back door? Okay. And careful with those candles. If the flames get near that one girl, her hair will go up like the Hindenburg. Turns out Terry wasn't kidding earlier. You have indeed got demons. Very, very tiny demons that you could probably easily step on, but hey, the effects on them are pretty good, so that's a plus.
Hurry up! Hurry up!
We represent the Lollipop Guild, bitch.
As if the demons weren't bad enough, they're also apparently made of sperm. Ugh.
Hello?
Hi, just calling to tell you answering a random phone call in a horror movie is usually a bad idea. See? What'd I tell ya? There's only one thing to do now. Use the heavy metal album against the demons. Huh. Okay, I guess the demons must be Slayer fans. Alright, now that the album's gone, just do what Canadians usually do in these situations. Say you're sorry and hope for the best. Or read them Bible quotes, I guess.
Deliver me from my enemies, Father in heaven, and save me from the devils of blood!
Uh-oh, looks like these demons don't appreciate being preached to. Alright, the gateway to hell may still be open, but again, good effects, especially considering what they had to work with. The budget for this movie was around $2.5 million, which wasn't a whole lot for 1987, but they managed to use that money pretty damn well in a lot of places here. Then again, considering the last movie I did was Things, a skid mark on a hooker's thong would look good by comparison. And forget reading the Bible, just fill the hole up with some dirt.
It's gone!
It's gone?
It's gone!
Well, I got news for you, Glenn. There's still 25 minutes and plenty of effects budget left in this movie. Ah! Oh god, the demons are back! Oh, wait, it's just your sister's friends. And what's with the garlic? You're in the gate, not Fright Night. Is there anyone else hiding in this place?
Boom!
What have you been doing, mud wrestling?
What were you all doing in that closet? Now that the gate's apparently closed, time to stay up and watch Quest for Fire. Hopefully it's the uncut version. Unfortunately, they get interrupted by zombie Dustin Hoffman from Little Big Man.
Keep it down, you damn kids!
Well, too bad Terry's been kidnapped. Although personally, I'd be mad at the band who apparently knew about all this and decided to make a cheesy metal album with the information. When did this movie switch from being about demons to disgruntled corn farmer zombies? Okay, again, gotta give the effects team props for this movie. And what are you so afraid of? Just step on the little demon things.
Dad's gun.
Oh, right, you have a shotgun. Just go get that. Ah! Oh shit, a hideous rat monster. Oh, never mind, it's just Terry. Barbies. The demon's one weakness. Okay, I gotta admit, even though I make fun of how small the demons are, this movie actually does do a pretty good job of making them seem creepy. And instead of hiding in the closet, you could try running out the front door. Well, the shotgun didn't work. Quick, try the Barbie again. Glenn's sister gets kidnapped too, which means the demons now have the two human sacrifices needed to fully open the gate. On the plus side though, now that your sister's gone, that means you can stay up and watch all the R-rated movies you want.
Love and Light. That's it. The Thunderbolt.
Nah, I'd still try using the shotgun first there, Glenn. Oh shit, there's still more surprisingly effective special effects in here! How the fuck are they doing all this?! And you know what they say, if you introduce a rocket in the first act, you damn well better use it in the third. You better hurry though, because it turns out the little demons aren't the only ones he has to deal with. Holy shit, Goro from Mortal Kombat! Alright, I know I've already said a lot about the effects in this movie, but seeing some well-done stop motion is always nice. And don't be afraid, the head demon just wants to congratulate you for doing such a good job in Blade. And slip you some acid, apparently. Well, both the demons and your sister are gone. Just come up with a convincing story for your parents and you should be in the clear. Well, maybe not. You still need to clean up your backyard. Somebody put some leftover effects from Twister in there. Actually, you know what? These are a little more believable than the effects from Twister.
Come back here! Take me instead! Come back! How do you want another sacrifice?
No. Canada already had a final sacrifice and it does not need another one. Here's another thing you may have noticed in this video. Despite the fact that this movie has a kid as the main character, I haven't made any Kenny jokes here. And that's because Stephen Dorff actually does a pretty good job in this movie.
Yeah, turns out you can have a kid as your protagonist in a horror movie and have him both be not annoying and have it make sense for him to be the focus.
And for the record, I'm totally not just saying all this because he kinda looks like me when I was a kid, okay? I think this is the first time a kid's blinded himself in order to keep masturbating. Glenn decides to make a final stand against the demons using the rocket, but he runs into a bit of a snag.
Damn you, Hasbro!
You better hurry up with those batteries, kid. The stop-motion gods are angry. I don't know why they didn't end up using these effects in John Carpenter's The Thing. They look pretty good to me.
No, I'm the Lord of Darkness and I'm defeated by a child's toy? Seriously?
Alright, so he's dead.
Nah, just kidding, he's fine. And it's also the 4th of July. Oh wait, I meant Canada Day, my bad. Good news, Glenn, you closed the gate to hell and brought all your friends back. Bad news, your parents' insurance doesn't cover demons and they're gonna have to go into debt to pay for all this. Ah well, you're a child actor, you didn't need to go to college anyway. The Gate was a reasonable success at the box office, making around $13 million, but it really found its true audience on cable and home video, where it gradually became regarded as a cult classic. And it's not hard to see why. The movie takes a little while to get going, but once it does, it delivers the goods. I think the best comparison I can make is to something like Poltergeist, in that it's a very effects-driven movie set in a normally safe suburban environment, and even though it's not rated R, it still feels like a horror movie and never seems like it's pussing out in order to get a wider audience. I wouldn't call this a great horror movie, but it is a fun one, and if you're someone looking to get your kids into horror but don't want to start with something too hardcore, this is a pretty good place to start.
So that's the end of my second Canucksploitation-a-thon, and let me tell you, it feels good to end on a high note. Well, that's all for now. Now, if you'll excuse me, I need to prepare for the return of an old friend. Until next time...
We accidentally summoned demons who used to rule the universe to come and take over the world.
Yeah, we found out about it from one of Terry's albums.